Om Jnana Timirandasya Gyanandana Salakaya Shakshurin Minitam Yena Tasmai Shri Guruve Shri Chaitanya Manobhistam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Dadati Swaparantikam Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadhara Sri Vasadi Gaura Bhaktavinoda. Hare Krishna. So I thought of going back to basics and just read some Srimad Bhagavatam, just to reconnect with the Bhagavatam. And somehow or other it opened up in the first canto, chapter 7, text number 1, the son of Drona punished. Sonekuvacha nigati naradasuta bhagavan badarayana shutavans tatabhi pritam tatakim akarut vibhu. Rishi Soneka asked, O Suta, the great and transcendental powerful Vyasadev heard everything from Sri Narada Muni. So after Narada's departure, what did Vyasadev do? Sutu vacha pramadyanam saraswatyam nasrama paschimitata samya prasaiti prukta rishinam shastravardhanam. Sri Suta Goswami said, on the western bank of the river Saraswati, which is intimately related with the Vedas, there's a cottage for meditation at Sampras, Samyapras, which enlivens the transcendental activities of sages. Purport. For spiritual advancement of knowledge, a suitable place and atmosphere are definitely required. The place on the western bank of the Saraswati is especially suitable for this purpose. And there's the ashram of Vyasadev at Samyapras. Srila Vyasadev was a householder, yet his residence place is called an ashram. An ashram is a place where spiritual culture is always foremost. It doesn't matter whether the place belongs to a householder or a mendicant. The whole Varnashram system is so designed that each and every status of life is called an ashram. This means that spiritual culture is the common factor for all. The brahmacharyas, the grihasthas, the vanaprasthas, and the sannyasis all belong to the same mission of life, namely, realization of the Supreme. Therefore, none of them are less important as far as spiritual culture is concerned. The difference is a matter of formality on the strength of renunciation. The sannyasis are held in high estimation on the strength of practical renunciation. Tasmin svaasram vyasu badri sannamandite asino paupas prisya prani dajo mana swayam. In that place, Srila Vyasadeva, in his own ashram, which was surrounded by berry trees, sat down to meditate after touching water for purification. Under instructions of his spiritual master, Srila Narada Muni, Vyasadeva concentrated his mind in a transcendental place of meditation. Bhakti yogena manasi samyak pranitihi te male apasyat purusham purnam mayam chatat apasrayam. Thus he fixed his mind, perfectly engaging it by linking it in devotional service, bhakti yoga, without any tinge of materialism. And thus he saw the absolute personality along with his external energy, which was under full control. And then there's a purport. Perfect vision of the absolute truth is possible only by the linking process of devotional service. This is confirmed in the Bhagavad Gita. One can perfectly realize the absolute truth, personality of God, only by the process of devotional service. And one can enter into the kingdom of God by such perfect knowledge. Hare Krishna. Om Gyane Timinandasya Gyanandana Salakya Shakshurun Minitam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurve Namaha. Shri Chaitanya Manobistam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Dadati Swapadantikam Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadha Shri Vasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare. Yes. So Srimad Bhagavatam is nice because Bhagavatam is always pointing at pure devotional service without any compromise and just full focus on somehow or other uncompromised devotional service. That is something we need. Here it is described how Vyasadeva was in a situation where he saw both the Supreme Lord and the material energy. And we also, to an extent, are in that situation because Oma Gyanati Marandasya Ginanana Salakya Shakshura Militamina Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha. Our darkened eyes have been opened by the torchlight of transcendental knowledge, by the mercy of the Guru Parampara. So as a result, we have transcendental knowledge, but we also have to deal with the material world and see the material world. So just like Vyasadeva. But of course, now that we see the Supreme Lord, we see that he is the cause of the material world, the ultimate cause, and he is the purpose of the material world. So whatever we do in this material world is for that, ultimately for Krishna, everything. And everything is meant to be offered to Krishna. So Srimad Bhagavatam is bringing us back to that. And that's why I'm happy to turn to Srimad Bhagavatam, because as I said, it takes us back to basics. That primary connection with Krishna as our priority. And then pure devotees. And then Prabhupada, the pure devotee who made everything possible for us, because Prabhupada is he is the one who brought Krishna consciousness to the Western world and set the standards for the Western world. Of course, his spiritual master did a lot of work in that regards to formulate the Hare Krishna movement for the modern times. Up to Srila Bhaktisiddhanta, the Vaishnavas were following the model of Rupa and Sanatan Goswamis. So all the Gaudiya Vaishnavas were living just as Rupa and Sanatan did in the Babaji Vesh, somewhere in Vrindavan, and trying to worship the Supreme Lord by chanting many, many names. Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur, he started like a active missionary program. He started the program of engaging with the world and injecting Krishna consciousness into the world. He organized in Calcutta on the Maidan, which is a big field in central Calcutta, and next to the Victoria Memorial. And there he organized the theistic exhibition. And it was quite a large exhibition. And it had a spiritual display, many dioramas of the entire philosophy of Krishna consciousness. And it had like 1 acre, 1 acre of land. It had a 3D map of India with all the holy places that Lord Chaitanya had visited on it, and his entire parikrama through South India on it. So like this, and then around it, there was a mundane exhibition with arts and crafts from different states. So they were on the external periphery of the festival, and just to attract many people, oh, Gujarati kitchen, yeah, yes, very nice. Oh, yes, oh, and over there, aha, yes, Tamil Nadu, we can have dosas and idlis. So, you know, food festival, it is still a popular thing these days. So Srila Bhakti Siddhanta, he organized like that in a very expert way, attracting people by making something of interest, and then in the core of it all, pure transcendental knowledge. And so Srila Bhakti Siddhanta engaged in so many ways with the modern world, and adjusted the style of Rupa and Sanatan, of the simple Babaji Vesh, just living very simple and very renounced, to engaging with the world around us. And for that sake, so Srila Bhakti Siddhanta, I've sometimes said, he himself came from tradition. He followed the same vows of Haridas Thakur, chanting 300,000 names every day, up to a vow to chant 1 billion names, which takes about, at a rate of 300,000, takes about 10 years. So that was a serious vow, and he did it for 10 years, chanting 300,000 names every day. And after completing that, it was Kunja Bihari who came, and one of his early disciples, he was from Calcutta. He was a lawyer from Calcutta, or a legal person from Calcutta. And he was really pushing Bhakti Siddhanta to go and preach in Calcutta, which he finally did. And then he started preaching big time. Anyhow, so, and then Prabhupada took that and took it a step further into a next century and went along with the modernization of the world and made connections with the modern lifestyle. And here we are, Krishna consciousness in the modern world. We have never seen much of the tradition of what was on the other side, right, of the bridge. You know, the traditional, more Vedic way of life. We all are part of this modern world. And I did go to India in search for Vedic India, in search for the spiritual essence of India. And yes, it was interesting. I found there many traditions which were favorable for spiritual life. People, when I first came to India, then water was mostly from wells. Yeah. So everyone had a well somewhere, yes. And so if you needed some water, you'd go to some place, some house, and you'd ask for some water, right? And from the well, yes. And they would pour some water from the well. There were public drinking spaces or places, and there was usually someone sitting there distributing water. Right? And they would stop and drink some water like that. And someone would just serve water as a seva. What to say? Of course, there were also, there were pipes with water and so on. That was more developed. But it was a life which was much more simple and more favorable for bhakti and for inquiry into the meaning of life. So here we live now in modernity, and Krishna consciousness has come into this modern world, and with all its challenges that people in the modern world are dealing with, yes, with all the electronics and all the machines that take us far away from nature. Far away from nature, we can sometimes it is good to reconnect and to leave the electronics for a while, to leave the big cities for a while, and to just stay out in a natural environment. The cities itself are good for engaging with many people because there we find that many people are actually educated and are looking for more meaning in life. So we see that there is scope. There is scope in the cities. Cities is good then for reaching out to others. It's not a great place to live. The country is better to live, better for family life, better for bringing up children, better for community. Just as Vyasadeva, he had his ashram on the western bank of the Saraswati, which would nowadays be in Pakistan, right? And so he also had a peaceful place, a place favorable for spiritual life. So these are some of the things that this Bhagavatam makes me think of. One second, I'll just take off some clothes because it's getting a little warm now. Yeah. And each phase of life has its own functions and roles to play. Children are, they bring youth back to their parents. As the parents, time had moved along and their youth was slipping away from them. But children bring back youth and make them a bit younger. And bring back enthusiasm and bring back fresh desire to explore and to learn and to do things. So it rejuvenates the association with children. In youth, yes, we are full of energy and we can finally pursue our personal desires, but we're lacking in wisdom. So midlife is busy, and then as we're getting older, then we become more reflective, and then this time is more for thinking deeper about the meaning of life and so on. Of course, in all stages of life, we try to make sure that transcendental knowledge is part of it. But still, in each age, each phase of life, there is obviously a different natural focus. I am... Well, we are going through the motions of time. And I'm now in the stage, in the reflective stage, the stage where I think about about life, about obviously the meaning of life is not a mystery anymore. How the meaning of life is something that that is clear by the mercy. By the mercy of the acharyas, we can easily see. We can see very clearly, very clearly. What for most people is the big question: what is really the real goal of life? What is the real aim of life? What is the real truth? And all these things. These are big, big questions. And for us, That's not an issue. Bhavanam jamanamante jnanavamam prapadite vasudeva savam miti samahatma sudurabha. So now let's go again. Oh, I've got to find the right mix. So maybe this is good. Yeah. So we have to find the right mix, and so for me, to be reflective is the main thing. I nourish that reflection by hearing and chanting. In that way, the reflection is about Krishna, about devotional service, and how to make it happen, and also not only what we make happen, but also what is happening, because we ourselves, we make something happen by our activity, and there also is something happening in terms of the flow of mercy coming from Krishna that enters into people's lives. And obviously that mercy is very important, because if that wasn't there, then I don't know how it would go on. Just like the Hare Krishna movement is not a movement which was founded by a human being or by human beings. Rather, it is a movement that is inspired by Krishna. Dharmasya tattvam nihitam guhayam. The absolute truth remains hidden in the heart of the Vaishnavas. So as transcendental knowledge was being realized in the hearts of the Vaishnavas, the Sankirtan movement gained momentum and gained depth. And so Srila Prabhupada made a society out of it. He made the International Society for Krishna Consciousness. Of course, his spiritual master already made a first attempt to organize the Sankirtan movement in an institution by making the Gaudiya Math, but that never really took so much shape, because he was there always present during his life as the Acharya. So in the presence of the Acharya, the Acharya is the institution, and whatever he says, that's what counts. So in this way, it didn't mean much, that there was an institution. There was actually an Acharya system, and that was predominant. After Srila Bhaktisiddhanta left, the Gaudiya Math splintered up in smaller sections and groups, each with their own Acharya. So in that way, it never really functioned like an institution. So ISKCON, in one sense, is the first experiment of having an institution. Yes, and here we have an institution, and at the same time, we also have an Acharya system. And of course we have, so there was an attempt to kind of secure the mercy of Krishna in the form of an institution. And the mercy of Krishna is traditionally preserved in parampara, in disciplic succession, in guru parampara. So all that took place, and that is what we have now. And then, of course, there's Krishna himself. And Krishna himself, he can do whatever he wants. Right? Krishna himself can intervene whenever he wants, in whatever way he wants. Krishna, he can talk to any one of us. It's like in Mayapur, it is said the deity of Lord Nrisingadev had been given by someone yellow stones. Right? I forgot the name of the stones. Cat's eye, I think it is. Anyway, some yellow stone. So someone donated these precious stones and wanted them to be used for eyes for Lord Nrisingadev. But the story is that there was some, so they did that, the pujaris did it, but then this lady came and she just, you know, she's just a visitor and she was not famous or anything, but she went before Lord Nrisingadev and Lord Nrisingadev told her, tell the pujaris that I want my eyes back. And she's shocked. And then the deity told her again, tell the pujaris I want my eyes back. So finally she did it. And then the pujaris quickly put the original eyes back. Good. So Krishna chooses. Krishna chose her. He didn't. I may have more stars and stripes, right? You know, and a danda and so many things, but he didn't choose me. He chose her, some unknown Mataji, some unknown lady, right? Nobody, one might say, from our perspective, nobody special. But somehow or other, Lord Nrisingadev gave her special mercy, right? I mean, he gave her the kind of mercy that stays with you for a whole lifetime. Right? When the Lord starts talking to you, well, that's pretty good. Right? That's not something you forget. Really. That stays with you. That's a lifetime gift of inspiration. So she got that mercy. So Krishna chooses. So the mercy is harnessed in an organization. The mercy is harnessed in the heart of pure Vaishnavas and in the parampara. It is, the mercy is harnessed in the scripture. The mercy is harnessed in the holy name. The mercy is harnessed in devotional service. And the mercy is directly given by the Lord. And he gives as he likes, as he is inspired. That is the nature of the Lord. The Lord, he is completely independent. So it is very nice to, and all this mercy is sustaining us. And it is because of that, that we are able to do something now, that we have a capacity to take initiatives, to connect with Krishna and his mercy. So this is Oma Gyanati Marandasya. This is what it means when the eyes, the darkened eyes, are opened. That is what it means. So yes, this is very nice and inspiring to me that we can connect with this mercy, and that is what we are aiming to do. That is our
Sure.
That is our objective, and Okay, 1 second. So, yeah, and we need to, again and again, reach out to that mercy. Otherwise, we dry up. Krishna may still make arrangements, even if we don't, and that is also there. But if we don't reach out, then to an extent, we dry up. So it's important that each time we just reach out, and reaching out to Krishna just means returning to basics, in a sense, returning to chanting, returning to kirtan, returning to Bhagavatam, returning to Krishna Prasadam, all these returning to deity worship, the basic things that bring spirituality into our life, that reconnect us. Yes, that is needed. Such things are needed again and again. And that's why I began with Srimad Bhagavatam. It's like I was a little tired from doing kirtan today, and so I felt that okay. Where do I get the inspiration to address you all? So I needed to connect. And by connecting to Bhagavatam, then it became, it came back to life. So this is what we need to find, ways to nourish ourselves again and again. Spiritual life depends on nourishment. And without nourishment, in the beginning, it seems not so important. Seems that we are strong, but over time, if that nourishment is not strongly there, then we are drying up. Then we are feeling that we are gradually drying up. So that is our challenge, to somehow or other find that nourishment again and again, and turn to that. Yeah, and that is the and of course, you know, like some people are very good in sadhana, some people are very good in service. It's a little individual how we connect, right? Some people they are very connected to scripture, and others are more practical, dealing with the things of the world, whatever may be. The real thing is this, that somehow or other, let us reach out to Krishna and Krishna consciousness. Okay, now let's see what we've got here. I wonder what we can do when we notice that devotees from the congregation are drifting off to other branches of the Chaitanya tree, gets attracted to Narayan Maharaj brands or other maths. Yeah, what to do? It's a big world with all kinds of Vaishnavas, and sometimes the Gaudiya Math, as it is existing today, has their institution is a bit more informal. So one reason why people are attracted to go there is because the authority is less formal. Yes. Another reason why people are going there because there is one guru, one spiritual focus, and everyone is focused on that one guru. In the time when Srila Prabhupada was present, ISKCON was like that. And after Srila Prabhupada was present, there were these zonal acharyas, and then in their zones, they were the central person. And whatever they desired, everybody was doing that. Yeah. So it's like, so everything was very focused, very bundled energy. So the Narayan Maharaj group still has that very strong focus on Narayan Maharaj. So it seems like a bit more bundled, you know, than all focused on the same thing. So that is another aspect that makes it attractive. And then, of course, some are attracted because of they discuss a bit more Raganuga Bhakti. And behind it, Narayan Maharaj also brought in a lot of tradition, you know, from our history, from the Gaudiya Vaishnava history. He was a learned Vaishnava who brought in plenty of tradition through Gaudiya Mahat. And Prabhupada, of course, came and transplanted this Krishna consciousness from east to west, and then what the Hare Krishna movement is today is some sort of a culture mix, one might say. On the one hand, it is based on pure transcendental instructions from Bhagavatam. On the other hand, there was a lot of influence of young Western hippies, right? And they brought some of their ways into the thing, then we got another wave later on. At one point, the people from India or Indian background started to discover this movement. And now there are so many people from Indian background in the Hare Krishna movement. In the beginning, it was not like that. In the beginning, it was all like Western people. Even in India, it's like when I was in India, the whole temple, all the temple devotees were all Western people. And there were no Indian people. Right? Some were favorable, but only later that we start to get more and more Indian devotees. And then at one point, so many Indian devotees came. So naturally, they also brought something with them. Right? They brought with them the culture, tradition, and their interpretation of Prabhupada. So now you had a mix of different interpretations of Prabhupada, Western interpretation, Indian interpretation, and here we are. So I find that interesting, how we are what we are. So we have our culture, that is my point. And Gaudiya Mat's culture is a little different. What do we do? If someone really, really wants to go there, what are we gonna do? We can, of course, encourage people to stay with ISKCON because we are particularly dedicated to Prabhupada. And if you go towards the Gaudiya Mat, then the focus is no longer Prabhupada, then the focus is Srila Bhakti Siddhanta and his followers. But you miss that special mercy of Srila Prabhupada. Therefore, we would never want to leave the shelter of ISKCON for the Gaudiya Mat. But some want, and if they're persistent, then inshallah, let the will of Allah be. Yeah? I think, you know, what to do? It is, water seeks its own level. It naturally finds its ways. I have one question. How to deal with family members who are also devotees when we have family-related disagreement or fight? Yeah. If they're also devotees, okay, then we can, on a devotional platform, try to appreciate each other. And as far as family matters, we may have some disagreement and some fight even sometimes. That's family life, right? So family life, unfortunately, always has these complications of some disagreements, some fights. Just the other day, someone called me and about an inheritance and how the family members were trying to cut this person out of the inheritance because of the connection with the Hare Krishna movement. And it just created a whole thing in the family. Right? So, yeah, there are always these things. We see that, you know, the ancestors of Rupa and Sanatan Goswamis, they were involved in some dispute over which the family had to go. And they originally hailed from Karnataka, but then they moved and finally settled in East Bengal. And so Rupa and Sanatan, with a whole group of brahmanas that had followed them from Karnataka, were having a whole little Karnataka community in Jessore, East Bengal, right? Because their ancestors were banned from their ancestral lands, you know, in some dispute. So yeah, nothing new under the sun. I guess try and resolve the matter and remain respectful to the devotees and to others also. Yeah, and I hope it will be resolved quickly. A technical question. You spoke about culture. How important it is for you that your lady disciples cover their hair? What is your general opinion about it? Srila Prabhupada, of course, was introducing this principle that ladies should cover their hair and were wearing a sari. And it particularly was suitable for ashram life. And it was like ashram life had many standards of behavior. Ashram life had also, had many details, rising very early and so on, and taking a cold bath is recommended, and all those things were followed. The men were very strict about the cold bath and stuff like this. So, as part of Asher, the issue came when the Grihastha ashram moved out of the temple, right? And Krishna consciousness went into the Grihastha ashram outside of the temple. And there were many people who came to Krishna consciousness who were never part of a temple ashram. And some of them are Krishna conscious and are chanting, but they never really wear dhotis, saris, or traditional robes or anything like that. Therefore, now we have a movement where there is so much, so much diversity into like different positions that people are in, that is difficult to now come with one blanket policy. All ladies should cover their hair. All I can say is that if we live in a traditional ashram setting or that kind of life, then that is appropriate. Then that is appropriate. Anyway, at home you can. It is not always easy, right? It's hot. It's suffocating. And ladies are not always comfortable with such things. So I feel that we don't want to impose, it depends in what setting. In a temple setting, in an ashram setting, it's something one could recommend. But then again, for residents, right? We'll have many devotees, who live in different situations, and they'll all come to the temple. And we don't want to create in the temple some sort of army sergeant atmosphere where someone says, all the ladies must cover their head. Cover your head, cover your head, cover. Why don't you cover your head? And some policemen have to stand there. So it's difficult, policemen or police ladies. It is difficult to make it happen. Therefore, I think that we now coexist, and we have within the Hare Krishna movement people who are situated in different ways in their Krishna consciousness. Some are living that very traditional ashram life and others not at all, but they may at the same time have their commitment to Krishna consciousness. So I would not impose it. I would not impose it rigidly, but if one lives a strict ashram life, then it is nice. Hare Krishna. Now, could you please elaborate on Ladini Shakti, the joy rendering power? Thank you. It is said that there is Sat Sit Anant, or eternity, knowledge and bliss. This eternity is found in Brahman, which is the foundation of all spiritual existence. The knowledge potency and eternity are found in Paramatma, the super soul, who is always, who is after all within the heart of every living being, and therefore is fully conscious of everything. But Krishna is relating to Anand, so that he's also eternal, he's also full of knowledge, but particularly he adds that element of bliss. So the Ladini Shakti is the pleasure potency, and that pleasure potency particularly belongs to Krishna. That is what preoccupies Krishna. He is always engaged with that pleasure potency. I was looking at some animated cartoons, and there's one person who is making cartoons about environmental issues. And you see, like, there's different cartoons, and one is man, and man comes out his planet, and man is totally destructive, is destroying all the animals, and it's just destroying the whole planet. And in the end, he sits like a king on a mountain of garbage, right? And it's very interesting, because man has like suppressed everything and destroyed everything. And then in the end, there's like only garbage and garbage and garbage. And then he sits on top of that on a throne like a king. It's kind of stuff. Doing these things, his name is Steve Cutts. Steve Cutts. And Steve Cutts, he is having different such clips on YouTube. And one is about happiness. And it shows the, right? You see all these people, there's all rats, you know? And they're all dressed up in, they're all running, and they're all dressed up in office clothing, and they all are on the railway platform to jump in the subway train. It's the New York-like setting. And it's all just moving, moving, moving. And then there are advertisements, and there's a movie, and the movie is called Happiness. And it says sold out. And then there is like, everything is happiness. You know, like you get a credit card, happiness. There's a drink advertisement, happiness, 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 happiness. And it's like everything is happiness. Every place is called happiness. So we're, and people are all running after happiness. And that's very clear. And yes, and there are different scenes that show this happiness. But he's having a hard time, right? It shows at one point, it shows Black Friday, right? So there's this shop, and the people are storming in, and they're grabbing all the things for really cheap, and it's a big fight and this and that. And in the end, the owner of the shop, exhausted as he is after the battlefield of Black Friday, drives away in a red sports car. And he's driving in his red sports car. And yeah, he's enjoying it like anything. And then he gets stuck in traffic. And then he gets a ticket while he's there. And then some punks, they come, and they just, while he's standing there, they start to take the wheels of his car. And there's nothing he can do about it, because they're heavy guys. And so they're just taking his wheels. And so, and he goes through all this, and he's, and he looks at one of these billboards, and he sees it advertised, happiness. And he goes up on the billboard and grabs a bottle, and it's a bottle of happiness and different types of drinks. He drinks vodka, and also called happiness. And then when he drinks the whole bottle, he smashes on the ground and he lies there. Yeah, what to do then? Then finally, he comes to the point where he needs medicated happiness. So he just jumps into this medicine jar, and he takes all these pills, and then he just, everything looks like Disney World, and it's a fairy tale and beautiful. And then he starts to fly, and he's in the sky, and he's with the birds. But then when he's really high, then he suddenly realizes that they have wings and he doesn't. Right? So he's there with his hands, like trying to fly, but he can't really fly. And suddenly, there's a thunderbolt, and he's alone in the sky, and he falls down. Boom. Yes, okay, so we saw something about happiness. So everyone is always looking after happiness. no matter what, racing after happiness. But in the that is on the material plane. So this drive for happiness, it comes from the Ladini Shakti. Because just like Krishna is always preoccupied with the Ladini Shakti, every living being is also always engaged with the Ladini Shakti. That is our connection, the Ladini Shakti. And it is only there that that happiness will be found. Only with the Ladini Shakti. And while we are looking for it elsewhere, we'll be running here and there. We'll be just running after happiness. And beware, you might need some medicated happiness at one point. Huh? Take your pills. Yes. Anyway, whatever. If that's what you need, then that's what you need. What can be done? Whatever it takes. But that's still not enough. Nothing enough. Nothing enough. Only Krishna, can give us real happiness. So yes, that is what we are aware about. This Ladini Shakti, the source of Krishna's pleasure and the source of our real pleasure as well. So let us learn more about it. Let's find out more about the Ladini Shakti. Rupanuga, Hare Krishna Rupanuga. I wonder what would be a good way to explain to people in general what true spirituality means. I've noted that currently with so many yoga studios and meditation groups, people have so many ideas about the meaning of spirituality, which are often not related with devotional service. Yes. Yes, that is very true. Well, I think there are different ways to connect with people in general. But yes, we must be relevant, right? And we can say, for example, I could say to general people that in traditional times, we see that people who were spiritually inclined would often turn away from the world. We see that there were monasteries and all over the world in remote places. And we see that people withdrew for their spiritual practices. But that is something that is very difficult to do in modern times. Bhakti yoga, therefore, the traditional ways are sometimes difficult to follow. Bhakti yoga is unique in one concept. In the concept of what is called in Sanskrit, yukta vairagya. And what that means is that you can take anything and connect it with a spiritual purpose. Anything. You just take things and find a way to connect it with a spiritual purpose. And it all becomes, uplifting. So no need to turn away from the world. Bhakti yoga can be practiced in the middle of the world. We can stay where we are. We can still live in the same house, still have the same job if we're not a butcher or any other forbidden activity. Okay? But if we have some occupations are not permitted, but otherwise, we can have a normal occupation. And in this way, we can live a life in the world and yet practice spiritual life. That makes a lot of sense in the modern world. Therefore, bhakti yoga is especially the yoga for the modern world. And bhakti, to do things with devotion, that is a natural thing, to give ourselves with dedication. Because that means love, to do something with love. Not just do it automatic, but bhakti means to do whatever we do with love. Not just love for the activity itself, or not just love for wanting to produce a nice product, but actually a deeper level of love, an all-inclusive love. Love for all living beings, and that ultimately has its roots in the Supreme Lord. So, like that, in a nutshell, this is bhakti. And therefore, bhakti, you could say, is the crown of yoga. Right? It is the crown of yoga. Therefore, after having practiced other yogas, it is natural that we come to bhakti. Bhakti is a way of life, a life as a servant, a life working for the welfare of others, as a servant of the Supreme Lord and all living beings. That is bhakti. Anyway, I could explain like that. Of course, it depends. You know, now I'm giving ideas and I'm not seeing someone in front of me. If I would see someone in front of me, then I would adjust to that person, you know what I mean? But in general, this is the direction I would go. How do we know if something is Krishna's plan and his desire, if it's our plan or our desire? Because we have the free will to make the choice of what situation we end up in. For example, we have the free will to be in a certain ashram. Yes. So, you know, that's all right, as long as we are within an ashram. Yeah? So Krishna gives us freedom to choose our ashram, and that's fine. But it's got to be an ashram. I had one disciple who was a bachelor, and he lived in a bachelor flat, and in every chair there were some clothes or books or other things. Right? There's no place to sit. A typical bachelor's flat, you know, a man alone. And so one day I told him, I said, why don't you choose an ashram? Why don't you choose an ashram? Right? Because if you want to be alone, why do you want to maintain a house? If you really want to be alone, then be a brahmachari. Right? But if you don't want to be alone and you want to be, then have a house and get a wife. Like this, choose an ashram, I told him. Bachelor is not an ashram. An ashram is giving us a particular shelter. Yes. So like this. Krishna gives us this freedom of choice. He does. So many choices to make. A Vaishnava is not alone. He doesn't make all these choices alone. A Vaishnava is always seeking blessings of the senior Vaishnavas, of the spiritual master and the senior Vaishnavas. So in this way, we don't just make our own plan. We also are looking to make our plan together with senior Vaishnavas. In this way, Krishna's will be known to us. Does a person's consciousness also extend to his, her personal belongings? And if so, when we give away personal belongings, such as old clothes, to charity, can the consciousness and karma of the person receiving it start to impact us? How should one then give away their personal belongings? No, if we give it away to some person, it is not that that we will get karma from that person. But generally speaking, are trying to give people Krishna consciousness. So it is not so beneficial to give things to others if Krishna is not connected to it also. If you have too many belongings, then you have a problem. Just give them away and see, and don't worry about what karma you'll get. See the blessings the people get from you. Right? You give away your clothes, and whoever wears them will be blessed because these were the devotees' clothes. And if you get some karma, you might get some karma. Yes. Don't worry about a little bit of karma. A little bit of karma is not going to kill you. Right? What to do? We got to take some karma from people if we want to give them the mercy. I notice that sometimes when I'm reading, I kind of space out and end up reading a few pages, not even knowing what I just read. Any tips on reading? Yeah. First of all, we read to purify the heart and not to become PhDs. We read to deepen our faith. So even if we don't remember everything, still as we're reading, our faith begins to grow. So that is one thing. Tips for reading in a more conscious way, start writing things down, make notes. Make notes of things that are, meaningful to you, right? Or if you are very analytical, then you can analyze a chapter and go for the whole structure and so on. So there's different ways. You can see how Burijan studied the Bhagavatam by grouping verses that cover the same topic together. And in this way, broke down chapters and summarized them by grouping verses together that deal with one topic. That's one way of studying. So besides reading, there is studying. We can take notes like that. Yeah, but I know what you're talking about. It's sometimes hard to focus. Bhishma Dev was a Mahajan, and according to scriptures, we are meant to follow in the footsteps of the Mahajans. But how can this be possible when Bhishma Dev was there in the arena when Draupadi was being disrobed, and he allowed that to happen without contesting? It is said that Bhishma Dev had been given some contaminated food, which he unknowingly ate, and therefore he became contaminated by that. And so that was the reason that he did not intervene at that time. So no fault of Bhishma Dev. Bhishma Dev is a perfect, pure devotee and must be followed. Gurudas wants to speak his question. Okay, Gurudas, go ahead, wherever you are.
Hare Krishna, Maharaj. Maharaj, I have a little confusion on this point about the mind and its desires. And I was just wondering that, is it the soul that has the desires? And I was listening to a little bit from Sahotra Maharaj, and he was making the point that if we just ignore the mind, it's almost like Mayavad understanding. And at the same time, I don't want to get caught up in over-analyzing the mind and all that, but I think it's a very interesting science, but it would be really nice to hear something from you, Maharaj.
Well, okay. So it is said that the soul can only be satisfied with the Ladini Shakti, with the pleasure potency of Krishna. And the material energy cannot bring any pleasure to the soul. The soul, when getting involved with the material energy, cannot find any pleasure here. Therefore, it is that the soul shuts down. The soul just shuts down and goes into a dormant state. It is then when the mind takes over the thinking, feeling, and willing, and therefore our current desires in this world are driven by the mind. And although the soul gives is the source of the energy of the mind, right? But the mind is pursuing all these different kinds of enjoyment. Therefore, therefore we have to learn to control the mind, and by some discipline, some regulation, another by engaging it in service, and in this way, the mind becomes subdued, and then the senses are subdued, and then the soul again awakens its natural desires to serve Krishna. Is that good enough?
Yeah, I'll have to think about it. No, it's definitely good enough, Maharaj. It's just I'm a bit slow thinking on this. It's quite a deep subject matter. It's just that the mind gets subdued, but then I also hear the mind only accepts and rejects.
Yes, but we can give the mind Krishna conscious choices. You know, you can have we give it a whole choice, but everything is prasadam. So yes, you accept and reject. That's okay. Okay, you reject the rice. You want the puris. Fine. Okay, here are the puris. So we just withdraw ourselves from mundane choices and just give our mind enough spiritual choices. Yeah. And in this way, we can accept and reject in Krishna consciousness.
That's really answered my question. Thank you so much, Maharaj.
All right. Thank you. Sorry. When it comes to the topic of caring for devotees, what aspect, in your opinion, Maharaj, is most important and needed nowadays? Thank you for being so caring. Yeah. Devotees. I think we need friends more than anything. And I think that's not just nowadays. I think friendships in this movement are very important. One cannot just live on philosophy alone and remain connected to a movement. Right? In order to remain connected to a movement, we can be convinced of philosophy, but we have to connect with some people within that movement who are actually our friends and who we trust and who we have faith in and who we find basically nice people who inspire us. So I think we should look for friends and we should give friendship to others. And I think that's that's the foundation of caring. And then, caring, we do our best to care for others as much as we can, you know. I mean, we have our limits there. I mean, I sometimes feel like, Yeah, you know, when there's one cartoon personality who I remember from my youth, whose name was Calimero. And Calimero was a bird. And Calimero, he was very small, and he still had half of the egg that he came from on his head, you know? And he was walking around like this with that piece of the egg on his head, just to show that he had just come from the egg. And Calimero would just say, I'm only very small, you know, I'm just small. And he would always emphasize that he was just small and that he was surrounded by so many great and overpowering things. So I am also Calimero, you know, that's another name I have, Calimero Swami. And as Calimero Swami, I just came out of the egg. And what can I say? I am surrounded by all these big things and people with big needs. And I sometimes find it daunting, you know? I mean, which means intimidating. When I look at, like, whoa, you know? What is expected from me? Whoa, that's quite something. My limitations, you know. I'm not like, I'm also not like Superman. So I think we should all care for each other. But I'll do my best, and we all do our best. I think friendships are the foundation. I feel also amongst us there has to be that friendship, yeah, where we really feel like that. Yes, you know, I'm acting as a guru. If that becomes a formal thing, if I become the formal representative of a tradition and of Krishna, it's possible to have an initiation on that basis, but it's not easy to invest in that. It's not easy to put one's heart into that, you know, into such an initiation. But when there is actually a personal relationship and a sense of friendship, yes, then it becomes easier to invest. You know? So I feel when that friendship is there, yeah, then I see a chance that we start actually caring. I don't think it can be in any other way. I don't think it can be in some formally organized care plan, you know, the HK care plan, you know, also known as the Hare Krishna care plan. I personally don't care very much for such an HK care program. I think I don't bet on that. I don't believe in that. I believe in friendship. And thank you for that question. I hope the answer is okay. If you don't like my answer, then, or if you feel it's incomplete, then you can always, you know, or if you want to add something, even if you like the answer, that's most welcome. You can then speak up on the mic and say something. Are the other ones? Oh, yeah, Hare Krishna, yes.
Hare Krishna Maharaj, please accept my humble obeisances.
Yes, Hare Krishna.
I just want to thank you so much for a beautiful answer. It really touches my heart deeply. So. You're such a real person. I just like that about yourself. You're such a real devotee. So thank you so much.
Anyway, I said no,
can I ask one?
Yeah,
can I ask one small question in relation to this. A long time ago, I heard you speaking about one pastime that happened in your life, one incident. But I cannot find it in all your lectures. I simply cannot find it. And I wanted actually to recall it. It's in relation to actually being a personalist in this moment and having personal relations. And also when dealing with people, trying to understand them and come to their place from there. So you were speaking about a couple, Italian couple living in Vrindavan at the time when you were temple commander or temple president. I'm not sure. They had an issue with AIDS and everything.
I know it, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And you know what I mean. So yeah. I wanted to remember, to recall this past time, because for me it was really significant how you dealt with that person. And he was able actually to understand what you were speaking. Mm-hmm. Can you please again?
I can try and I'll do a little introduction. Of course, in a temple like Vrindavan, which is the spiritual, one of our spiritual headquarters in the world, naturally, we have people from all kinds of backgrounds in the ashram, all different countries, different cultures, different languages, and east, west, and then India, for example, you don't put the Tamils next to the Gujaratis, that doesn't work very well. They have a natural sensitivity, right? So it was a whole puzzle, who could stay next to who. So I kind of start to learn that each particular person had its own background and its own way of doing things. So there was a devotee, and he was a couple, and he's Italian. They were Italian, and Italians, they love to eat and they love to cook, and so she was always inviting people to the house, but she was HIV positive. And especially in those days, people didn't know so much about it. And a lot of people were very apprehensive. And she didn't tell them before. And then when they heard it after, they didn't like it, right? So they complained to me, and then I had to tell the people. So anyway, what I did was I did it the Italian way, of what I thought was the Italian way. I'm after all a pumpkin from Holland, and I know there are some Italians here and they might get offended, but what I did is I said if I would have done it the Dutch way, I would have just said, well, I got some complaints, and I have to talk to you about it, right? I would have started right there and said, look, it's about your wife and inviting all these people and so on. But I realized that with an Italian, you can't be Dutch, So I said, Prabhu, I have to tell you something. I have to tell you something. He says, oh, you have to tell me something. You have to tell me. So please tell me. I said, Prabhu, I have to tell you something, but I can't. He says, no, please, no. You must tell me. I said, Prabhu, I cannot tell you. No. Please tell me. No, Prabhu, I can't. No, please tell me. Prabhu, it is about your wife. Oh, no, not my wife. Oh, no. Yeah. I said, yeah, I know. And like this, and then, after gradually we came through the whole story, and it's like, yes, your wife. inviting the people, and Rachel, oh yes, she loves cooking so much. I understand. And then in the end, he said, oh, he told me such a terrible thing, but he told it in such a nice way. Yeah. So that was the success, you know, in trying to also try to understand the mood people have. You know, I think when we talk to someone, we should respect them and respect their feelings and respect their mood. And so be sensitive to their mood. And I think then communication will go better. Anyway, I'm still learning this. I'm still stepping on people's toes all the time. And yeah, I'm still a blunt Dutchman, sometimes a little too blunt. But other times, of course, we Dutch people, we think that to be straightforward and direct is a virtue, right? We have made mistakes like, you know, if you just tell the truth to someone's face, just the truth, even if it's ugly, but that you tell the truth, that's beautiful. That's Dutch, right? So, yes, what to do? So we still do it sometimes. It's just second nature, what to do. So if I do that to you and embarrass you in public, then you please let me know and I'll try and improve. Okay, I hope that was okay. Uh-huh. Then we have, you mentioned about becoming dried up due to lack of nourishment. Going back to basics of hearing and chanting, nourishing your reflections. I heard a lecture by Mother Urmila on CC comparing Ramachandrapuri's position to that of Oscar's Puri. Maybe that's a spell checker, Oscar's Puri.
Ishwara Puri.
Okay. Yeah, that was a spell checker. She said Ishwara Puri was an ocean of love of God because he got the mercy of his guru by two things, menial service, and secondly, understanding his guru's mood, whereas Ramachandrapuri became dried up because of criticizing and fault-finding. Yes, one can become dried up by an offense, but one can also become dried up by... So Ramachandrapuri became dried up by making an offense to his spiritual master, minimizing his spiritual master, and then fault-finding and criticizing. But one can also become dried up by being neglectful. Inattentive chanting is also an offense. Neglectful chanting or neglect our reading. So that will also dry us up. So we have to sravana kirtana jala sechana. We have to regularly water the plant of bhakti with sravana kirtana, with hearing and chanting, like that. How can we do menial service for you and align to or understand your mood? Oh, yeah, menial service. When I'm not physically present, then you may not be able to do some physical service, but you can do some service in this preaching mission and that in Prabhupada's movement. And I am, you know, trying, along with many others, trying to strengthen Prabhupada's movement, uphold Prabhupada's movement, develop Prabhupada's movement. So if you also take up that work of upholding, strengthening, and developing Prabhupada's movement, then that is the most wonderful service. Because I've given all my energy to that. Oh, starting work again from Monday. Yes, that is good. After having been ill. Yes, it is good to, pace yourself, you know. Don't start running on the first day. But yes, it is good. It is good to be active and Prabhu said that it's also respect for Radharani if women cover their heads. Yeah. Ultimately, we are getting the reason why ladies are covering their heads because the ladies have because they are reflections of Srimati Radharani. And Srimati Radharani, the form, female form, is a reflection of the form of Srimati Radharani. The male form is a reflection of Krishna. And it said, Radharani is more powerful in attracting Krishna than Krishna is in attracting Radharani. Therefore, Radharani is, therefore the female form is more powerful in attracting the male form than the male form is in attracting the female form. It's like, therefore, the Vedic culture is a culture where the clothes are elegant, but at the same time are covering the body so that that lust will be diminished in social life. That is the aim of dressing in Vedic culture. So covering the head is, the purpose is to diminish lust in social life. And it is an austerity. It is certainly an austerity for the ladies to go through this. And it is not that everyone who's connected to this movement may feel comfortable with that, and I wouldn't force people. I think it must be something that one can naturally do so. You commented on how people in this movement come from various backgrounds and we can't have a rigid policy. To what extent do we let someone grow in this movement at their own pace and just lead by example before we need to actively intervene or impose the more rigid rules? Yes, I think that it depends, you know, like there are four regulative principles. And these four regulative principles are very central to the teachings. So sooner or later, we'll try and encourage people to start following four regulative principles. But some people can never fully do so, and yet they can do service. And there is a chapter 12 in the Bhagavad Gita which gives a whole bunch of clauses of for those who cannot follow. If you cannot follow this, if you cannot follow that, then, yeah, and it tells you, then do this, then do that. So there are chapter 12 people who can who are connected to Krishna consciousness, but cannot follow all the rules very strictly. So we have to see. As I said again, in a temple ashram, there must be a high spiritual standard and a high standard of ashram rules, because the temple is meant to be the home of of sacredness. It is meant to be a shelter where we go for purity. So therefore, those who live in the temple have to follow the high standards. If those who live at home, they may follow as good as possible. And there we can be a little more lenient, but obviously we cannot accept illicit activity in the Sangha of the Vaishnavas. No intoxication or not eating of unedible things in the association of the Vaishnavas. That cannot be. No mundane music in the association of the Vaishnavas. That cannot be. So there we have to protect the Sangha or the group or the meeting of the Vaishnavas. But otherwise, okay, I know some people, they sometimes drink. They do. But they are devotees. They don't drink around devotees, but when they're alone, they sometimes drink. Now, that's not good, but what are we going to do? We also can't send these people away altogether, isn't it? They still have some connection. They're also, in their own way, devotees, but they're weak devotees. And they have a weakness. So in this way, rigidity is something that can only be applied in certain circumstances, strictness, and then with sensitivity. Yeah. What is the relevance of Vadu in Vidya Vadu Jivanam? Yeah. That is part of a verse that deals with the intimate exchanges that Krishna has with the gopis, who he accepts as his wives, although they have a paramour relationship. But at the same time, it says, by stealing the clothes of the gopis, Krishna accepted them as his wives. So, and then it means the life and soul, that relationship is not ordinary. That relationship is transcendental, and it is based on pure love. So that is behind it, of life and soul. That is the essence of pure love. Okay. Some bug in my room again. I have to catch it. There are these. Okay, 1 second. I see the bug and I'm going to catch it. So, got it. There's these flying bugs that fly around the room. And I don't know where they come from, but every once in a while they pop up. And, and then they hide again. So once I see them, then I catch them with a box, plastic box on top, and then out the door. Sorry. Yeah. A South Indian devotee, she's a worldwide well-known devotee giving lectures. She told me that if she covered her hair at home, her mom would have slapped her at her face. it was the Muslims to bring the covering of hair culture in India. Well, yeah, but that's not really what Srila Prabhupada taught us. No, I mean, what can I say? So maybe in South India now, such ideas are there, but no, Srila Prabhupada clearly responded to the Bhagavatam verse where women are like fire, men are like butter, and then if they come close, the butter melts. Therefore, women are recommended to cover the fire. That's the origin of it. Now, how we're going to do that in the modern times and in the modern culture? Again, you know, it depends where we are, where we live, and how we live. Right? And if we are not ashram devotees, then I don't think we have to. Whenever we are not in our material clothes and suddenly put on spiritual clothes, quickly cover that head. I think that would be too much of an austerity for many ladies. And I don't think it is required to put someone's emphasis on that. But it's also like the ladies are tying their hair, right? Because it said when hair is hanging loose, then it incites lust. That's, for example, that's in different scriptures. But for example, Kavi Karnapur describes that in his Chaitanya Chandradoy Natak. So just to confirm, Krishna's will is known to us through senior devotees whilst making decisions. Yes, yes, yes. And especially, and for big decisions through the spiritual master. Giriraj has started writing small books as he's inspired by BBT and also the story of Baladev Vijayabhusan writing his Govinda Bhashya to establish a sampradaya. Giriraj wants an inspiration of a book to write. He's asking you whether there's any topic he can write to serve you or your writings. Okay, I have to think of a topic he can write about. Well, you know, I really like the story of Govardhan, right? Because it is so amazing that Krishna lifts a whole hill and then all the cowherd men and all the cowherd women and all the cows and all the calves and all, they all fit under the hill. Oh, you know, there are so many. How can all of Vrindavan fit under that hill? But Krishna makes it possible. And I really like that, you know, that Krishna gives shelter, you know, to everyone. I think that is really beautiful about Govardhan, that Krishna just gave shelter to all the residents of Vrindavan. I think it's a beautiful story, the Govardhan story.
I've kind of already written that book.
Oh, far out. That's amazing. Krishna must have inspired
Gita.
Huh?
Write it like not like the whole Bhagavad Gita, just like a mini kind of Bhagavad Gita.
Okay, yeah. Okay, well, it's wonderful that you're writing. I mean, that's a great service, you know, writing. Yeah, it's very, very good. People will really like it. We're all going to read it. Whenever it's ready, then your father will give it and we'll distribute it to everyone and we'll all read it. We can't wait. We're excited. Yeah. That's far out that you're writing a book. Wow.
And my dad was saying, if I could, I'm already sorry.
He wants to send it to Jayadvaita Swami for the
BB. Yeah. Well, he's expert. He's expert with books, you know? Yes, he's the best. Yes, yes, yes. Yeah, we can arrange that. No problem. Yes. That's cool. But I want it also, huh? You should send it to me also. Okay, then. How important is it to understand the spiritual master's mood after taking initiation? Does this affect how we receive instructions? Well, you know, mood, the spiritual master's mood, it simply means that what is important to our spiritual master? So it is important to know what is important to our spiritual master. Not just be a disciple according to the handbook, you know. And it says, when I see my spiritual master, I must bow down. When I, you know, like that, I must offer obeisances, I must say his pranam mantra. That's one thing, right? That's according to the handbook. But now, what is important to our spiritual master? And that is something, yeah, something very, very, very wonderful, right? The other day, I saw somewhere where some disciples of Jai Pataki Maharaj asked him the question, if there is something, if there was something that he had never told his disciples and that he actually always wanted to tell them. And then he told them that he always wanted to tell them to be kind. To be kind. He says it seems like such a simple thing, such a human thing. But he said, that is so important. To be kind. He says, everything depends on that, to be kind. So, of course, you know, that's like, yeah, just my thing, you know? That's just, I can totally relate to that, and I really appreciate that statement a lot, because I also feel like that, you know. When I speak about friendship, being kind, I think is something very important, and as a foundation of making this movement grow. So yes, I like that mood of Jai Pataki Maharaj. Anyway, Tulsi Manjari is there and expressing some appreciation. Thank you, Tulsi Manjari, and I'm very happy that you could join us, and yeah, that is very nice. And others seem to agree. Okay, I can read it out. You give us a lot of mercy by sharing your good wisdom and many realizations. I feel this is how you serve us, and I'm personally really grateful for this. Yeah, well, you know, I mean, it's also nice to share. You're also giving me an opportunity to speak. All the languages. Yeah. Anyway, to be sensitive. I wish I would be sensitive. It's not so easy to be sensitive. But we'll try. But I speak different languages, and one thing I like about different languages is not only a different way to speak, but it's a whole different mood. Right? So when you go in a different language, you go in a different mood. I appreciate that about different languages. Maharaj, in what level is the guru-disciple relation friendship, and how deep can it go? We are often that seniors are merciful to the innocent, equals can be real friends on equal terms, and so on. Can you please explain more? Maybe an example or two from your experience as a spiritual master and some of your disciples. No names need to be mentioned. Thank you. Well, okay, let's see if an example comes to mind, you know, because I'm not so good at, like, can you give two examples and, can, you know. But in principle, friendship is there. Yes, it's there is an element of senior junior, of course, you know, and in one sense teacher and student or parental is sometimes given as a model. So there is something of sharing more experience with someone who's less experienced, but the essence of that friendship is trust, right? And that we know that we are, you know, that from both sides, that there is trust and appreciation. And that if that's there from both sides, right? Trust and appreciation, genuine, then, you know, the exchange will happen. Right? If I face someone who is not having so much faith in me, not really trusting me, but who is my disciple and who is worshiping me out of formality, yeah, you know, and everything is done out of it doesn't sit right. There has to be something genuinely heartfelt. Okay, it's 9 o'clock and there are still more questions, but it is getting late for me. Sometimes somebody does something inappropriate and we don't say anything well and close our eyes and pray that Krishna will correct them, this person. We get to get this. No, we cannot always directly correct everyone and everything. You know, of course, if it is too much, if there is extreme misbehavior, yeah, then we have to say something. But if it's a devotee who is a bit slack here, a bit slack there, we cannot just constantly be the one who's just pointing out faults to everyone, and then we have no relationships. So we should build relationships with people. And then we can maybe, and we should know when to say something, when not to say. Okay. I thank you. And I wish you all a wonderful week. And I really hope to see you again next week or before that. And yeah, I'm going to get ready to have a good night rest. And I'm still struggling with this blood pressure, and I still need to sort of keep it cool, and these kirtans, you know, I mean, like, I tried to have a cool kirtan today, but it did drive up the pressure a bit. Anyway, let's see if we can bring it down, and then tomorrow I'll try and do another mellow kirtan. And okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Maharaj.
Hare Krishna.
Thank you, Maharaj.
Thank you very much. Nice to see you.